Hello, darlings. You've all heard of Marilyn Monroe.
Welcome back, darlings. I'm TV host, entertainment journalist, Cognac Willa Lane. And in just a moment, I will be interviewing Ms. Noelle Benson. She just wrote a fascinating book, What Men Don't Know About Dating Is a Lot, a must read for all you gents out there. So stay tuned. Let's look at this fascinating interview with writer Noelle Benson. Welcome back, darlings. I'm TV host, entertainment journalist, Cognac Weller Lane. And my very, very special guest for today is writer Noelle Benson, and she just wrote a fantastic publication and a book, and we are going to learn more about this book in just a moment. Welcome, Noelle, to my beautiful pink kitchen. As you can see behind me, I have a fabulous pink kitchen. As you know, I love pink. That's my favorite color. So now that we are all squared away, I wanted to tell my audience a little bit about you before we get into the questions. So, Noelle was raised in Pennsylvania, Lehigh Valley in the 60s, 70s, and 80s when people didn't lock their homes. Remember that? And there was no cell phones or security cameras. Tom Petty may say about her, she had a good-looking mama that never was around, but she grew up short and she grew up right, and then Pennsylvania boys on them Pennsylvania nights, she is a Chester County resident. Noelle was never the prettiest girl in high school, but she was one of the prettiest. More than that, she had a personality and she was wild, smart, fun, quick-witted, funny, athletic, popular, adventurous, playful, ambitious, competitive, and mischievous. In high school, she always had to be at all the best parties. If she wasn't, it was because she was grounded. Unlike former President Bill Clinton, Noelle inhaled. She had an abundance of girl and guy friends back then and still has many of the same ones today. She's a good friend to have. She's the daughter of two college grads. Her mother was Westchester University and her father was from the University of Delaware. Her mom was an elementary school teacher and her dad was a World War II vet. My father was too, World War II vet. So, and now he's a financial executive. She has an older sister and Noelle graduated in the top 10% of the high school class and went on to State College in Pennsylvania's Amish country of Lancaster County, where she was honored with three scholarships for outstanding achievements in news and feature writing. So now, my first question to you is, tell my audience where your passion for writing came from.
Well, first of all, Cognac, I'd like to thank you for having me on your show. I'm so honored, and I love your pink house. I love
it. It's my pleasure, darling. It's my pleasure.
So and pink is one of my
tell us the reason.
It's one of my favorites too.
Come from for writing.
Okay, so when I was in college, I was a communications major, and I thought I wanted to be a news anchor. I thought I wanted to be the talent on television. So between my junior and senior year, I did an internship at a television station. And I was the camera person. I worked behind the scenes It was an unpaid internship. And I realized that stories that required more time and more attention were getting 10, 20, 30 second spots. That's all, I mean, because TV is time, right?
Yes.
So that's when I decided, I mean, I knew I always wanted to tell stories. I was always a storyteller, but I decided then to switch from TV to newspaper because I knew I would have more, not time, but more inches to tell story. Because as time is to TV, as inches is to newspaper, right?
So
that's, and I was always very good at telling stories. I'm lively, I'm animated, I'm mischievous, as you said. So,
yes. So I think as a writer, writers always have like a very curious mind. They're very curious mm-hmm. about things. And I'm more of a TV host than I am mm-hmm. a writer. But I tend to be very curious about things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so when I was growing up, I was curious. But back in the day, you know, my family used to say, you're so nosy. And they just, now it's curious, right? But they always, yeah, nosy.
Yeah, but, well, that's what makes you a good, reporter. A good writer, you have to be nosy. You have to ask the right questions. You have to know about, you know, what's going on currently in the world. I mean, all these things play, these are all factors into becoming a good writer. And you have to also research and make sure what you're writing about, if it's true, it's accurate.
I was just going to say that. You have to not only research, but you have to research more than one source. You know, I feel like today people hear one thing and they react like Chicken Little, the sky is falling. You know, I was never a knee-jerk reaction kind of person. I hear something and I think to myself, I don't know if that's true. So, you know, you check two or three references and you'll find out the truth. For sure.
Well, you know, like, I'll give you an example. Because I'm in media, a lot of times I know things are true and I know they're not true. Like, my husband will read something in a newspaper about the Hamptons. Oh, these people have to do this and they have to do that and they have to show credentials and they can't get into a restaurant if they don't show, you know, like this latest thing with the vaccination.
Right.
So I see... Let me tell you something. A lot of this is hype for the restaurant. You know, they hype it up. It's not always exactly true. They do that for publicity purposes to make people think, wow, to get into this restaurant, I can't get a table. This must be a fabulous place. I got to try to get a table, you know?
Exactly.
So I tell my husband, don't believe everything you hear in the newspaper, I mean, read in the newspaper or hear on television, because a lot of it is publicity and a lot of it is hype.
Yeah, of course. You have to check your sources.
Now, I also want to ask you, tell us about your history in writing and the challenges you faced.
You know, I think I've been very lucky, Cognac. I really haven't faced many challenges. I would say, being edited by senior editors and copy editors, that would be the most challenging. But you learn early as a writer, and especially cutting your teeth at being a newspaper, entry-level newspaper reporter, you better throw your ego out the door, right?
Yeah, I would have to say when I first started doing what I'm doing, because that wasn't really my goal. I wasn't really looking to be a TV host and an entertainment journalist. I really wanted to be a movie star. That was my goal when I was a little girl.
You are a star.
But I mean, when I was little, that's what I wanted to be, like Marilyn Monroe and, you know, Jane Mansfield and Elizabeth Taylor and, you know, all those great, big, beautiful movie stars.
I read that about you.
Yes. So I really got into this by accident. And, you know, of course, I thought by interviewing all these celebrities, which I did, I've interviewed hundreds of celebrities on the red carpet, you know, that's where you think that, the, you know, you can't have any, you can't think that that's, you know, going to get you a TV show or on mainstream right. television. So you're right, your ego goes out the window because there's so many right. people doing this. There's so many people interviewing that, you know, they just look at you like you're just another reporter. You know, I mean, right. did you feel like that? Didn't you feel that way a lot of times? They're looking at me like, well, I'm a good reporter, but in a sense, they look at you like, well, you're not, you're just a, you know, you're just a reporter. Did you feel that way?
No, I didn't, because after I graduated from college, 4 days after I graduated from college, I got on a plane and I flew to the West Coast. So I was cutting my teeth out in Los Angeles. And I have to say that it was mostly a male-dominated industry back yeah. then. So I really was unique. You know, I was female, young, petite, blonde. So I didn't feel like that. I did feel like, however, that because I was young, female, petite, blonde, that they had that stereotype down
yes.
as being dumb. But I learned, and I did resent that initially, but then I thought, you know what? I can use this to my advantage. That's going to be my secret weapon. They're going to start talking and they're going to be talking too much and they're going to let something slip that they don't want to slip. So yeah, I just was always super polite and super nice and taking copious notes. Had my little tape recorder with me, of course, and really worked hard. But they found out quickly that I was a force and that I wasn't dumb, and that they needed to show me the same respect that they were showing the other male reporters, whether it was reporters from other newspapers, other television stations, other radio stations. So yeah, so that's that. I guess that would have been a challenge at the time too.
Just yes, I would think so.
In the male workplace.
Now, what did you report? I mean, what kind of, who were you into? Was it basic news or was it entertainment?
No, I was doing news. But because, you know, news, you're reporting facts, objectively presenting facts to the public.
Now, you just worked on something recently, and that's what we're here for. We're really here to talk about your latest project, your publication, your new publication, What Men Don't Know About Dating. Tell us why you decided to write this book. Now, is this the only book you've ever written, or have you written other books?
No, this is my only book. It's my first book. And I wrote my book because I had a story in my soul. I have been in the online dating community since 2012. And I can't tell you how inauthentic online dating can be. And I have thought about this since my book came out in mid-May. And so this is just July 2nd. So over the course of those weeks, what is that, 6 or 7 weeks, I have been asked about, well, why would someone misrepresent on their profile? You're going to eventually meet and they're going to be found out. And I said, yeah. And I initially didn't have the answer. All I knew was that that's what they were doing. Okay. But having thought seriously about it in the last 7 weeks, because I've been interviewed and I wanted to have a better answer. So I did start doing some research on it. And the best answer I can come up with is about why online dating is so inauthentic in the majority of cases, is that because people want other people to like them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had a girlfriend, she told me this. She tried this online. This poor girl, she's passed. She was even younger than me, and this poor girl died. She was so unhappy. She had gotten divorced from her husband, and she tried the dating scene. And she said that every person that she hooked up with through the online dating, the men, not the women, it's the men, they lie. They lie about their appearance. They lie about themselves. They lie. They send a different picture. And every man she met through this online dating told her, you're exactly what your picture says. You're exactly the way you look. And everything about you is exact. But every single man she met, they were all lies. Yes. And they're clueless about the way they look, these people, when they go on a date. They don't even know how to dress.
And that's why my book is so important. This is a dating guide for men.
Not women, only men.
Only men, because I don't date women. So I don't have any experience with women.
Now, did you, this information that, of course, I know you researched, is this based on your dating, or did you research it with other women, what they went through?
It's based on my dating experience and then also other women's, but it didn't really, I mean, if you want to include my girlfriends telling me their horror stories as research, then yes, research, but none of that is included. The only thing that's included in my book is my research, my experience. And this, look, it's a short book, okay? It's an easy read for men. It's blunt.
And we have to make it easy for them because they won't read. You know how they are.
My Audible version is in the works because so many men say they don't read. But here's the thing. If you are a single man and you want to date in the online dating community post-pandemic, you need to know what you're getting into. For instance, if a man thought to himself during pandemic, you know, after this pandemic, I'm gonna start golfing. I've always wanted to golf. This pandemic has told me to not put off anything because there is so much uncertainty in our lives. He wouldn't just go out and go buy golf clothes and go to a country club and pick up a threesome that needed a fourth and go out on the links. He would not do it. That's the same thing as dating. Just because you're single doesn't mean you're ready to date. And my girl right here on the cover says that in her little blurb. Just because you're single, you're not ready to date. Okay? You need to do prep work. You need to not only shop and groom, practice self-care and self-love, you need to work on the outside for sure.
Yeah, impressions are everything. The first 2 minutes of a person meeting somebody, forget it. If they don't like the way you look, it's over. It's over.
In the intro of my book, I actually quote a statistic. It's not even 2 minutes. It's a fraction of a second of first impression.
Wow.
Yeah. So.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So not only do they have to be relevant on the outside, they have to do shadow work. They have to find out what's going on with them, because if you want someone to like you, being inauthentic in your dating profile is not the way to go about it. You have to present authentically who you are and what you want. And you're not going to be able to get that if you're inauthentic in the online dating community. And my book is focused at the online dating community post-pandemic, because let's face it, a lot of marriages did not make it through isolation, sequestering, lockdown, shelter in place, social distancing, whatever you want to call it, that broke a lot of marriages. So there is a new community of men who are newly single, and they are flooding the dating websites. And believe me, they are floundering. But that's because they didn't do prep work before getting on the online dating website. Before they get on the online dating website, they should pregame. And that's a chapter in my book. It's called Pregame. They need to know what their intention is. They have to know what they want. Oh, Cognac, I can't tell you how many times I've been on
a... they're like really totally oblivious or ignorant or, here I am, come and get me. Is that, that's what it's like?
It kind of it is.
Can you tell my, what was the weirdest experience you ever had with online dating with a man?
Well, I can tell you, I want to use current experiences because there's very many weird ones.
Yeah.
I mean, I could go on.
I just can imagine.
But currently, the biggest issue is, and I want to stay focused on this new community of men post-pandemic. They're not even divorced, okay? So if a man says he's separated, let's really call that what that is. You're married. Okay, separated is married. Okay, so you should not be on an online dating website. So I did, after I met a man online, we messaged back and forth on the dating website. I felt comfortable enough. I got to that point where we traded phone numbers and we were texting. We made a lunch date, so I felt very safe. I met him there, and Cognac, I can't tell you, I was so pleased. He was handsome. He had great hair. He had great teeth. He was dressed well. I was like, oh my gosh.
He had charisma. Yeah, he had every,
Well, let's not get carried away.
But he was good looking. Yeah.
Outside looked good. So I thought, oh my gosh, this is going to be good. So as we sat down to lunch, and we started talking, I noticed that he had a hard time having continuity in his stories. He jumped around a lot to stories, and I had to rein him back in to tell me a full story so I could have a beginning, middle, end. But then he started throwing back pretty heavily, and he was on an empty stomach. He did not eat breakfast. He was having cocktails before. Served cocktails. I'm not gonna lie, I had a glass of wine too, but he was drinking pretty fast. And he was mixing. I can tell you that date went south so fast. And this is what he told me, get ready. He said he was a kept man and that he lives with a woman and she's mean and he doesn't like her. He doesn't know how he got himself in this situation.
It sounds like a similar story I hear all the time.
Okay, first of all, if you're living with another woman, you should not be on a dating website.
Right.
And if you're too scared to be independent and on your own, you should not be on a dating website.
How old was this man?
He was our age. I know, right? That's pathetic. That is pathetic.
And
I can tell you.
It really is. There's so much I would like to talk to you about. We're really kind of running out of time. But your book sounds fascinating. A must read. What men don't know about dating is a lot. Now,
yes.
I want you to tell my audience, Noelle, where can we go to find out more information about you? And your book.
They
do
can go
website.
To,
yep. Do you have a website?
I do not. Well, it's on Amazon.
Okay.
They can go to Amazon.com and they can search my book by the name, What Men Don't Know About Dating is a Lot, or they can search it by my name, Noelle Benson. Now, my pen name is Noelle Benson and my legal name is Noelle Benson. However, for the book, I spelled Noelle, N-O-E-L-L-E. My legal spelling, yes. So my legal spelling of my name is N-O-E-L, but I specifically spelled my name, N-O-E-L-L-E, so newcomers would know that a female wrote this. And my book is very, I come from a point of love and understanding. I'm not angry with men. I used to be angry.
They just don't know.
Just don't know. And right now my sales are doing great. I couldn't be happier. But women are out buying my book 3-1 to men. I mean, so women are buying it, and that's great. I love it, and I'm getting so many fabulous reviews. I have 5-star reviews on Amazon.
But you really want the men to read it because they need to know this. They need this knowledge so that they can have a successful relationship and go on beyond the first date. If you don't know how to treat a woman or you don't know how to act on a date, you're not going to go past that first date with anybody.
The first date's going to be a last date. I have had so many first dates.
That's the whole purpose of this book. We want relationships to grow from the date, not just the first date.
Correct. And that's I have a lot of information about COVID and sequestering and isolation and finding inside of yourself what you really want. Are you tired of being alone? I mean, people have been isolated for a long time. And if you really want to connect, then you have to be authentic and you have to meet in person. Otherwise, you're just going to keep spending time with your devices. And when I say devices, I mean cell phones.
Fabulous. Tell my audience, do you have a Facebook?
Yeah.
What's the Facebook? Noelle Benson?
Yes.
Okay.
Spelled Noelbenson on Facebook.
Noelle, we're out of time, but I adore you. And I cannot wait for this video to go off so my audience will know. And please, you guys out there, listen to Noelle. She knows what she's talking about. But don't go away yet, Noelle, because I want to talk after we stop recording. And darlings, I want to give you a big pink champagne kiss, Noelle. Mwah! I wish I could do it in person. And we will be back. We will be back with more interviews, more celebrity interviews right here at Cognac's Corner Magazine. Pink champagne kisses.
Well, I hope you enjoyed my fascinating interview with writer Noelle Benson. I certainly did. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to my YouTube channel and always ring the notification bell to let you know when I publish a new video. I always publish a video every Sunday or Monday. And my interviews are always about celebrities and shopping hauls with Shein, Fashion Nova, Bath & Body Works, Victoria's Secret, and of course my very favorite, Amazon. So if you haven't already, please subscribe, and I love you all. Pink champagne kisses.
Hello, darlings. You've all heard of Marilyn Monroe. Some of you know Bridget Bardot. Well, now it's time for the Cognac Show. And the Cognac. Line, fabulously dressed to impress, one of a kind girl. I was brought into this world wrapped up in pearls. I love to mingle, though my husband reminds me I'm not single. I meet and greet both the famous and the elite. I ride in limousines, drinking the finest champagne, wearing furs, dazzling diamond jewelry. A girl can't complain. I live the upscale life, dining in the finest restaurants, eating the best caviar for free. And no matter how much I enjoy cognac, ooh, ooh, I sip cognac, ooh, ooh, ooh.
This has been a Crybaby Productions, darlings.